Okay, TurretinFan, you can now set forth your negative rebuttal. You may begin when you're ready.
Thanks very much. It's been a pleasure to debate today. I'd like to thank Mr. Albrecht for his participation and for bearing with my questions and answers. Now I'd like to sort of summarize the debate. The debate was over the question of whether or not the Bible promotes the veneration of Mary. And although we saw that Mary is praised in the scriptures, she's called blessed, she's described as having been highly favored, she's described as a modest and humble woman, and as Mr. Albrecht pointed out, she was greatly privileged to have the incarnate Son of God at her breast. Nevertheless, there's nothing in Scripture that commands any Christian to give her any special reverence or honor. And so the Roman Catholic view of Hyper-Dulia is completely unbiblical, as we've discovered. Remember, the first section that we talked about was the fact that Mary's portrayal in Scripture is relatively minor. She's only mentioned once outside of the Gospels by name, and only mentioned once by name in Mark, never by name in John, and never by Paul. In fact, as we discussed in the second section, when Paul talks about who is the mother of us all, he doesn't point, as many might expect, to Mary, but instead he points to the heavenly Jerusalem. She doesn't have a specific role that is taught by Scripture as far as having any maternal relationship to us, such that the fifth commandment, that we should honor our father and mother, would apply in some sense so that we would have to honor her using that sort of maternal honor, which would still not be hyperdulia, but let's continue on. We also saw that the scriptures describe her as a witness to Jesus' life, and that as well as a great privilege that we can't experience because we're not around during Jesus' earthly ministry, and that she was cared for by the beloved disciple John and interviewed by Luke, who was in the process of preparing the Gospel of Luke. All these things said, we also saw that there are three passages, which may all be the same event, in which, far from suggesting that Mary is to be specially praised, it's suggested that she simply just the same as any other believer. And Mr. Albrecht himself brought this out in his last speech when he pointed the verse which says that indeed, truly is blessed the person who believes. You see, all believers are equally blessed with Mary. There's nothing particularly special about her, and that's really the point of those verses. When we also saw as well, and this wasn't disputed at all by Mr. Albrecht, that when the author of Hebrews describes Jesus, he calls him without mother, and really this undermines this special title among many exalted titles that the Roman Catholic Church uses. This title, Mother of God, is not only unbiblical, it's contrary to the Bible in that falls afoul of Hebrews 7:3, which describes Jesus as being like Melchizedek, being without father or mother, without father as to his humanity, without mother as to his divinity. Then, when we investigated the arguments that Mr. Albrecht made, we didn't hear what you would expect. We didn't hear any verses where there was a command to honor Mary, or an example even of someone giving special honor or special reverence to Mary, aside from the greeting of the angel and the greeting of Elizabeth that we already talked about. There's no examples of anyone giving her special attention, and the one case where we saw something close to giving her special attention is the point where Jesus took the opportunity to say, "Oh no, she's nothing special, she's just the same as all the other believers." Mr. Albrecht tries to make an argument from silence on Luke 1:28. He says, "Well, she was given this privilege in the past, and that had a continuing effect at the time the angel spoke to her. And there's nothing that ever tells us it stopped." Well, indeed, there's nothing that tells us whether it stopped or it continued, and it's just simply an argument from silence on that point. He makes a point about something being in a titular form only in Luke 1:28, but it's hardly ever used throughout Scripture. The word itself is hardly ever used throughout Scripture, and it's not particularly rare to have people described in terms of characteristics. And in this case, the characteristic that was salient was the fact that she had been privileged with having the Son of God come and be in her womb. The next argument that we heard was one about all generations calling her blessed, which Mr. Albrecht continually seemed to try to convert from simple statement of fact that all generations will indeed call her blessed to a command that we must, as though this were an order. You must call her blessed. It doesn't say that. I think we tried to bring that out in the cross-examination, and instead we got a, well, but shouldn't we? You know, that it's not in the text. It doesn't say that we are to do so. It just says that people will call her blessed. And the reason why we call her blessed, of course, is that she received an enormous blessing from God. It's quite true. It was an immense privilege for her to be the mother of Jesus, to have the incarnate Son of God in her womb. It was an extraordinary blessing, and she is blessed, and we call her blessed. But that's a far cry from giving her hyperdulia. The next argument was one from Galatians about how we serve one another in love, but of course, again, that's not hyperdulia. That's not veneration in the sense of a cultus, in the sense of when we talk about religious veneration in theology, we're not talking simply about obeying the second table of the law. When the fourth argument was this argument from Behold Your Mother, but as we discovered, that was specifically made to John, and there's nowhere in Scripture that suggests or implies or states that this is to have any broader application than John. And of course, John himself, while he did care for Mary, he never mentions her by name in his gospel, although, of course, he does mention her without using her name. We hear from Mr. Albrecht that Scriptures are very clear on this issue. He started his initial speech with that. He mentioned it in his last one, and I wouldn't be surprised if he mentions it in his final speech. But what they're clearly here is clearly silent. They never give any examples of people venerating Mary in any special way without Jesus coming and saying, wait a minute, she's just the same as anyone else. And we never have any commands or instructions or exhortations to venerate Mary in any particular way. And instead of that, instead of those commands, instead of those instructions, we have a relegation of Mary essentially to the Gospels, with a brief mention at the very beginning of Acts, no mention throughout Paul's epistles. She's not this central figure next to Jesus. She's not described as the Queen of Heaven or any of these other exalted titles that are given in Roman Catholicism today. In short, what we see is that the entire cult of Mary, the entire worship in the form of hyperdulia of Mary that we see in Roman Catholicism today is unbiblical, and consequently, when Christians are seeking to follow the Bible and to follow what the apostles taught, which we know through Scriptures, we are not to worship Mary, we're not to give her special reverence, special attention, and we're not to treat her any different from any other believer, although she was greatly privileged, and although she was given great favor from God.